second scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Job. And Job is, excuse me, I've got a cold coming, so my voice starts to go. Job is one of those difficult books and difficult people in the Bible sometimes we have to wrestle with. Job was known as a man of great suffering and sorrow. Many times his story is part of the Lenten journey. And they use Job as an expression of sackcloth and ashes, how part of our human experience is to have to wrestle with and live through times of grief and trouble. But there's also a marvelous story, if you will, behind Job. He is a man who holds on to the righteousness of God in a way that we all should strive for. But he has his moments. And this morning we're going to read some of the words that Job speaks as he wrestles with the struggles in his life. Hear now the words from Job, chapter 30, various selected scriptures. Job says this, "And now my life ebbs away, and days of suffering grip me. Night pierces my bones, and my gnawing pains never rest. I cry out to you, O God, but you do not answer. I stand up, but you merely look at me. Surely no one lays a hand on a broken man when he cries for help in his distress. Have I not wept for those in trouble? Has not my soul grieved for the poor? Yet when I hoped for good, evil came. When I looked for light, then came darkness. The churning inside me never stops, and days of suffering confront me. I go about blackened, but not by the sun. I stand up for help in the assembly and cry for help." These are the words of Job, spoken in the midst of his suffering. I had shared with Taylor earlier this morning that we're going to talk about imitators and being imitators of Christ. And that Ephesian scripture we shared this morning that Rich read for us starts with these words, "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Be imitators of God. That's the message I hope to share with us today and encourage us to strive in our own individual lives and as a church to become more and more the imitators of Christ. The scripture that Rich shares a couple of encouragements and traits that are associated with being imitators of Christ. In verse 9 it says, "For the fruit of light consists of goodness, righteousness, and truth." And those are the things that we should strive for in our individual lives as imitators of Christ. Goodness and truth and kindness. So what does it mean to imitate? Taylor and I kind of shared a little bit of that. What really does it mean to imitate something? Is it really just to copy that? Or is it to become everything that's involved with that? Imitation is more than just copying something. It is a process of emulating fully that which you are trying to imitate. And there's a process involved with it, and it starts with observation, watching that person or that thing that you're trying to imitate, and learning all you can about it. It starts with observation. And the next step of imitation is then to copy. You mimic what you see. But that's not the fullness of imitation, because we can learn about something and we can copy something, but until we actually put it into practice, it amounts to nothing. Follow what I'm saying? An example I would kind of give for this is when I was a kid,
growing up, watching the Red Sox, there was one pitcher back in the 70s that I wanted to be like. I wanted to imitate that person. Do you remember Louis Tiant? Oh, he was a very dynamic pitcher. He had a windup that was just something spectacular. I'm going to imitate again and embarrass myself. But I used to practice this for hours. And he would come down with his windup and he would do this. And then he'd stop. And then he'd go into his windup and he'd literally look at second base. Some people. And then he'd throw the ball. And I can remember as a kid wanting to be like Louis Tiant, wanting to practice and be just like him. And I would practice those moves. So I observed him. I learned his motions. I copied him. But guess what? Why are you laughing? You know exactly where I'm going, right? I'm no Louis Tiant, and I am no pitcher for the Red Sox or anybody else. So all of that work came to nothing. I mean, it was good because I learned how to practice and commit to things, but ultimately that imitation, that thing I was striving to be, never happened, and it amounted to nothing. We look at the world around us, and I think Rich even mentioned it when he read the Ephesians scripture. It talks about evil and so forth in there, and it sounds a lot like the world. The question I have for you is, who would you want your children or grandchildren to imitate in this day and age? When you look around at all the sports figures and all the entertainment figures, all the politicians, all the business people, who do you want your children to imitate? I think for most of us, there's probably friends or family members that we'd really like our children to imitate, but in the broader world, there's very few people that I'd want my children or grandchildren to imitate. As Christians, we have been given the gift of the one person we should always strive to imitate, and that is the person that is Jesus Christ, because he is not only God in perfection, but he was the perfect human being. The only one of us to ever walk this world and live this life and go through it without sin. If you want to strive to imitate someone, that's who you go to. And this is what Ephesians and Paul is speaking to. We're entering into the season of Lent, which traditionally in the church is a 40-day period from Ash Wednesday to Easter. And the focus of Lent has always been to look at your life. Identify those things in your life that are hindering a full relationship between yourself and God and perhaps others. And then make that intentional choice to step away from them and imitate Christ. There's a saying in physics that nature abhors a vacuum. And when you're in the season of Lent, looking at your life, trying to identify those things that are keeping you from imitating Christ fully, and then you make the decision to step away from them or set them aside, you should replace them with something positive, something good, something more Christ-like. Fill that void, if you will. A couple of weeks ago, we had talked that Lent was coming up, and there was a newspaper article I shared with you that kind of gave us the concept, instead of just simply giving something up for Lent, that we should give of ourselves for Lent. That it should be more than perhaps setting aside your cell phone for a while. That we should, when we do that, then replace it with something else. And in this case, they were encouraging people to actively engage with charitable organizations and find out what it is they need, and then personally go and meet their need. Taking something that separates you from a full relationship and replacing it with something that will help you to imitate Christ more fully. In Job, I mentioned Job as I read the scripture, and that's always a difficult subject and difficult person to to speak about and preach about on a Sunday morning. People want to come to church and they want to be uplifted and have something positive to carry out with them. And here comes Job. And this guy has the worst of the worst in his life throughout Scripture, that story of Job. It's a heavy, heavy, hard story. But there's something in there that I think we can take out of it that should encourage us and should lift us up. He's a man of suffering and sorrows. He even uses that term, I'm a man living in sackcloth and ashes. His life is a mess. And he's symbolic of how many of us can feel at times in our lives when the bad stuff comes and we're just overwhelmed with it. I struggle personally with trying to tie Job, the understanding of Job, into Lent. And this idea of repenting, turning away from whatever you've done wrong and replacing it with something more positive. Because when you understand Job, he did nothing wrong. The story of Job is he was a righteous man, and he was a man after God's own heart, and he was doing all the right things. And here in Job, we're introduced for the first time to that person whom we don't ever want to talk about, which is Satan, the devil. And he comes to God and says, you know, Job's not as great as you think he is. And God says, well, I believe he is. So basically, God allows Satan, representing evil, to come into Job's life. And Job goes through all these terrible things. We know the story. He loses all his possessions. He loses his family. He loses his health. And we hear the words that in the midst of all that struggle, that evil that comes into his own life, he is in suffering and sorrow. But he didn't do anything. None of the decisions he made caused this evil to come. And many of us still, and all of us, I would say, struggle with that concept. Why do bad things happen to good people? And the answer is we live in a world where there is evil. And many times it can come into your life in its various shapes and forms due to nothing you've done yourself. No decisions you've made. Nothing. That's the reality of our human existence. And this is what has happened to Job. I think it's interesting that Job's experience can relate to us today and help us to understand perhaps a little bit better what evil can be. And that's a difficult subject in church on a Sunday morning. I understand that, but I think it's important. What is evil? There's many people, theologians, have tried to describe that and give us a picture and understanding of it, particularly the evil that comes into our lives that we have no control over. I want to offer some suggestions today. It's not the only way to look at it, but for me, it helps in my own spiritual journey. I want to start by asking us to consider how we measure some things in our physical world. Heat and cold. How do we measure heat and cold? Temperature, right? Use a function called temperature. And temperature is a reflection of how much energy is in an object. You get really physical with it, the atoms move back and forth, right? There's more energy, and if something's got more energy in it, what happens? It warms up. We physically measure the amount of energy, the amount of heat in something. We don't measure the amount of cold. We measure the amount of heat, the energy that's there. The same thing with light and dark. In science, how do we evaluate levels of light? Something called lumens in the engineering world. We measure the amount of light that there is present. We don't measure how much darkness there is. We measure how much light there is. One of the concepts I have of evil, this is something I was given, it really reflects to me that evil works much like this when we evaluate it. Evil cannot be measured. It is rather the absence of something, the absence of love. we can understand the amount of love that God has given the world. And evil would be the absence of that love, the inability to access God's love for us, if you follow what I'm saying. I have something in one of my study guides that talks about evil as a shadow. I want to share that with you this morning. The figure of the devil, or Satan, whom we just read about this morning, first shows up in the book of Job. And Satan is evil personified. Evil is a shadow that cannot stand on its own. A shadow by itself is nothing but the absence of life. Theologically speaking, evil is made manifest, becomes present, when someone or something stands between us and the light of God shining through Christ, blocks the love that God has for us. One way to look at evil is by thinking about the number -2. I'm going to go back to some of your math here, right? What is -2? It's impossible to have -2 of something. I can't hold it in my hand. I can't put it in a box because -2 doesn't exist. It only exists as an absence. You can have 2 fewer of something, but you can never have -2 in and of itself. Evil, therefore, is a manifestation of nothingness. It is a shadow. Shadows are real, but they are only seen when we block the light. So when we surround ourselves with the light of Christ, in essence, evil cannot exist. For me, that's kind of a helpful way to try to understand that very difficult concept that we have to wrestle with as Christians. And when I look at Job's story, this is exactly what I see present in his life. Satan, in this case, evil has come into his life and it has cast a shadow. It has separated him from the love that he used to experience from God. God didn't change. God didn't remove himself. Something came between Job and his relationship with his Lord. It's a nothingness that came between. So Lent, for me and hopefully for us, is an opportunity to evaluate our lives to see what things perhaps we have in them that are like nothing. Things that we do or perhaps don't do, like my hoping to imitate Louis Tiant, amount to nothing. Because when that nothingness is there, I am separated from the fullness of the love of Christ for me. So we have a choice. We have a choice to be able to evaluate our lives, to see those things that we might be doing that really don't matter, that don't allow us to enter into the fullness of Christ's love for us, and then replace them with the good things that Christ has, to imitate, to choose to imitate those values of Jesus that will draw us closer to him and to one another. So what are the things that perhaps we do that don't help our relationship with one another and with God to flourish and grow? Ephesians mentioned a couple that Rich read. Big ticket items, if you want to call them that. Greed, idolatry, immorality. The one I always like is foolish talk. Those are kind of big ticket items that lead to nothing fruitful in our lives. But we all have smaller ones too. It's easy to sit on the computer and play a video game for an hour and a half and it comes to nothing. The entertainment's kind of nice, but in reality, it comes to nothing. There are other things that perhaps we allow to filter into our daily lives that keep us from being fully imitating Christ. Work, being busy. You wouldn't think that, but a lot of people are so busy that they have no time to spend quietly with their Lord or with others. That's something I always have to be careful of, not allowing my life to be filled with too much stuff. But we're called to replace those things during Lent, to identify them and step away and allow something else to come into our lives. So what are some of the things of Christ's life that we could replace these things, fill that nothingness with? Any ideas?
Prayer.
Our district superintendent was here a couple weeks ago, and he stressed that very much. Prayer, taking the time to intentionally pray, is a good step. That will help draw you into a deeper relationship with one another and with Christ. What else?
Study the Bible.
Study Bible. We mentioned the devotionals out front. Those are opportunities as well. What other things? Take it one step further and offer to pray with others that may not feel comfortable with it or may not...
Or don't see people much.
Or don't see people much. Go find someone who's by themselves and help them visit and pray with them. Okay? What else?
Music.
Pardon me?
Like music.
Music. Music can work. Take some time to turn the TV off and listen to some great Christian music. I had some list of things, traits that Jesus practiced in his life that we could emulate, imitate, and help ourselves grow closer to one another in him. Love and grace. We talked about love with Taylor this morning. Hospitality. Practicing hospitality with people. Inviting the stranger into our midst. We had a discussion on Friday, just Friday afternoon, we had a meeting, and the word inclusion came up, that Jesus was someone who included everyone. Hospitality is a visible expression of including the stranger into our midst. Humility. Here's a big trait of Christ that he practiced regularly that many of us could be intentional, more intentional about being humble. Being willing to serve others and care for others in spite of what we might want to do. Respect. The scripture is great. God has always given us the answers to these kinds of questions and encourages us to delve into them and practice them. Micah 6:8 says this, "What does the Lord require of you? What does he want you to imitate? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." This is how we imitate God. Practice justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. I'm going to my study Bible again. In that simple phrase, very short scripture, Micah offers us a three-part journey on what it looks like to imitate God. First, we are called to do justice. It means taking a step back, looking at the big picture, and asking difficult questions such as, why are people hungry? How can education be more effective? And why does poverty exist? Second, we are called to offer works of kindness and mercy, one-on-one acts of kindness like offering a meal, listening to someone who is struggling, or visiting the sick and the imprisoned. Mercy and justice go hand in hand. Mercy is feeding someone who is hungry, and justice is asking why he or she is hungry in the first place. And finally, we must walk humbly with God. On the day of Pentecost, when people ask Peter what they are supposed to do, he replies this way, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven." In other words, Humble yourself, seek forgiveness, and turn toward God. Fall in love with God. Do this, and God's promises will be yours. So we are in Lent. We're entering that season of Lent, where we're striving to seek to live more and more in the light of Christ. When you're in the light, the shadow cannot exist. We are here to make those decisions to replace those things that separate or weaken our relationships and be intentional by replacing them with the traits of Christ. Removing the obstacles to full relationships. We can do this in many practical ways, each of us, in our own way. We can support a just cause. We can get involved with one of the many recovery centers that is trying to spring up all around central New Hampshire. We can serve others. We can be intentional about going to the hospital and visiting someone who's sick, or be intentional about going to the elderly centers and perhaps bringing them some music in the middle of the day. We can dedicate a quiet time with God through prayer and devotion, meditation. We can make do with less. In our consumerist society, all of us can practice that one. We all have way more than we need and strive to make do with less and perhaps pass it on to someone who truly does need it. These are the ways we imitate God. These are the ways we imitate Christ. These are the ways we each have the power to overcome the shadow of evil by being a people and children of light and sharing God's grace with the world around us. So be intentional. Be imitators of Christ. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you this day, just reveling in the presence of your light, understanding that sometimes being in the brightness of your light shows the shadows in our life. So Lord, we come before you this day to choose to be your people, to grow closer to you and to one another by practicing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly. We ask that you give us the grace to imitate you every day and in every way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.